Well, a very good evening and many thanks indeed for joining us. My name is Omolu Chino and this is KTV Primetime News Series of Monday, the 18th day of July, the year 2022. Tonight, we have a lot in store for you and what is happening in the country and, of course, beyond our borders. But first, let's take a look at the stories making headlines tonight. Relief for Kenyans as government announced 4 weeks subsidy prompting fall in maize flour prices. Kenya and Seychelles signed 10 agreements to cement bilateral ties on President Uhuru's state visit. Crumbling hopes for Mike Sonko as IBC revokes clearance to contest in the Mombasa gubernatorial race. The Law Society of Kenya launched an initiative to deliver justice for victims of extrajudicial killings.
This is KUTV Primetime News with Omondi Otieno.
Welcome to the broadcast, and I'm not alone. I'm with the company of Moses Gitonga, who's our sign language interpreter tonight. Now, you're streaming live this broadcast on our social media platforms on Facebook, KUTV Kenya, on Twitter, KUTV underscore Kenya. Now, Kenyans can now comfortably put their staple food on their tables as 2 kg packet of maize flour now set to retail at 100 Kenyan shillings. The internal communication document in the Ministry of Agriculture, signed by Agriculture Principal Secretary Francis Owino, stated that the ministry shall subsidize the maize production and scale prices for maize for a period of 4 weeks.
2 kg packet maize flour prices as from today will retail at 100 Kenya shillings from 230 Kenya shillings. This has come as a relief to consumers who have been managing escalated maize meal costs, fortified by the high cost of living that has affected other households' essentials such as cooking oil, wheat and maize flour, sugar, milk, bread and tissue papers. According to an internal memo in the Ministry of Agriculture, signed earlier today by the Press of Agriculture Francis Owino, the ministry shall subsidize the production and sale prices of the maize flour for a period of 4 weeks. The document also adds that apart from the 2 kg prices, the 5 kg will retail at 250 and 10 kilograms at 490 Kenya shillings. The document states that representatives from the ministry will be posted to the different millers to confirm the sale of the maize flour into the market. A section of the Kenya Kwanza politicians have claimed the immediate drop attack to coax the electorate before the polls, with Kikuyu MP Kimani Ichung'wa and ANC leader Musalia Mudavadi saying it will be better if the government dropped prices for other essentials like fuel and rice.
Shukisha hata bei ya mafuta, shukisha bei ya mchele, shukisha mpaka ya chumvi na ya petroli. Sababu tunajua mpango wenu ulikuwa ni kupandisha bei ya unga, muhonge watu na unga ya relief ya serikali.
Hawajashukisha bei ya mafuta ya kupika, hawajashukisha bei ya petroli, hawajashukisha bei ya sukari. Alafu wanasema wanataka washukishe bei ya unga kwa mwezi mmoja.
The cost of living has been on a constant incline, contribute to an increase in the fuel cost and subsequently food prices. The drop in maize flour prices is a relevant move, with ugali being a staple food to most households in the country. Nyambura Kabura, KUTV.
And now President Uhuru Kenyatta and his host President Ramkawalan witnessed the signing of the Pacts of State House Victoria in the Indian Ocean Island nation of Seychelles. Key among the signed agreements was one on cooperation in the blue economy sector, which seeks to enhance capacity building, as our reporter Mwaka Samuel now informs us.
President Uhuru Kenyatta and his host President Wavelram Kalawan witnessed the signing of the pact at State House Victoria in the Indian Ocean island nation of Seychelles. President Kenyatta commended the Joint Cooperation Committee of the two nations for putting together the agreements that were signed, which outlined the avenues to be explored to enable Kenyan Seychelles to fully maximize and further solidify the existing ties.
Our discussions have revolved around many aspects, key of which are trade between Kenya and the Seychelles, our diplomatic cooperation, tourism, blue economy, maritime affairs, especially the re-establishment of sea routes and links between our two countries.
On his part, President Ram Kalawan said President Kenyatta's visit to Seychelles was significant to the two countries as it reaffirmed the multifaceted relation the two nations have enjoyed over the years.
I'd like to commend and thank the Joint Cooperation Committee that has put down all the agreements that we have signed today in order to outline avenues that we can explore now and into the future where our countries can maximize and move together.
He expressed gratitude with the Kenyan government for its continued support to the socio-economic growth of Seychelles, saying currently there were 846 Kenyans living in the country, among them several expatriates in the education and health sectors.
First of all, we reminded ourselves of the bonds of history and personal friendship that unite our two peoples. Seychellois and Kenyans have known each other like forever.
Foreign Affairs Cabinet Secretary Ambassador Rachel Omamo signed the agreements on the Kenyan side, while Seychelles Foreign Affairs and Tourism Minister Sylvester Rakegonde signed on behalf of his country. Mwaka Samuel, KUTV.
On the Independent Electoral Boundaries Commission, IEBC, has withdrawn former Nairobi Governor Mike Sonko's registration certificate, preventing him from contesting the Mombasa County gubernatorial race. In a letter penned by Mombasa County Returning Officer Swala Ibrahim, IEBC stated that Sonko went against Chapter 6 of the Constitution.
Independent Electoral and Boundaries Commission, IEBC, has revoked former Nairobi Governor Mike Sonko's registration certificate, putting a halt on his ambition to inherit Mombasa County's top job. Mombasa County Returning Officer Swala Ibrahim stated in a letter to Sonko that the latest developments were associated to a Supreme Court ruling on 15th July that upheld the former governor's impeachment, and I quote, "In adherence to the Supreme Court judgment, you are therefore disqualified from holding any public office and thus disqualified from contesting and being elected as the governor Mombasa County or any other county. Your candidature is invalidated and your certificate revoked." Swala Ibrahim also stated that a person may be disqualified from running for office if they are found guilty of abuse of office, and I quote, "I wish to draw your attention to the fact that on 15th July 2022, the Supreme Court of Kenya in the subject of the appeal held that your impeachment was procedurally fair and in accordance of the Constitution, that you are removed from office for contravening the provision of Chapter 6 of the Constitution, and that you have exhausted all possibilities of appeal or review of your impeachment." Meanwhile, Sonko, who is unhappy with the decision that effectively bars him from holding any political office, has petitioned the Supreme Court for a review of the decision, besides resolving to challenge the decision at the East African Court of Justice. Kevin Omondi, KUTV.
And away from that, the Law Society of Kenya, in collaboration with the Kenya Human Rights Commission, International Justice Mission and Mothers of Victims and Survivors Network, today organized a meeting to discuss the role LSK is playing towards achieving Kenya's initiative against extrajudicial killings. Our reporter Mark Kirungu with the details.
Mission, International Justice Mission and Mothers of Victims and Survivors Network, in a mission to seek much-needed justice for victims of extrajudicial killings, with the focus of helping survivors and families who have lost members to extrajudicial killings or forced disappearance, get documentation for a class action lawsuit for compensation, amongst others.
So today, the Law Society, together
with the International Justice Mission, Missing Voices, Amnesty International, and the Social Justice Working Group will be forming a coalition to work together with the Mothers of the Victims and Survivors Network, which is a recognized community-based organization that seeks to give a voice to the mothers and the survivors of the victims of extrajudicial killings and enforced disappearance.
Mothers of Victims and Survivors Network have condemned law enforcement officers for using excessive force against their children in informal settlements while reminiscing on the past events of violence that have occurred in the past elections.
Yeah, 2017, haikuwa clashes, lakini ni maskari ndio walimwagwa. Na hata walikuwa wanaingia kwa mlango door to door, wakitoa watu ndani ya nyumba, wakipiga. Sio wote tu kitabu jaguzia wote, lakini wachache wale ambao tulitembea. Tunataka tumalize hii mauaji ya maskari. Wananyanyasa watoto sana. Kule ghetto, kijana hizi kukua na dreads kama huyu kijana hivi. Kijana hizi kuvaa safi. Anaulizwa kwa ni yeye ametoa wapi pesa ya kununua nguo safi ama nguo ya pesa mingi. Na akiwa na dreads, wanaambiwa ni wezi. Sasa tunasikia kama tuko na huzuni sana, kama sisi wazazi.
The meeting comes in the wake of a confirmation by Nakuru Police Commander Peter Mwanzo on the identification of four people killed by police in Barut, Nakuru West sub-county on Friday morning on suspicion of being members of a criminal gang during a security operation.
In the security forces, those who have developed this habit will from today cease and desist from undertaking extrajudicial killings. But if they don't, then they will be met with the full force of the law.
LSK President Mr. Eric Theory stated that police brutality and extrajudicial killings have no room in Kenya society and cautioned security officers against using excessive force as they will now be held accountable by law.
With the Law Society of Kenya still hard at work seeking justice for victims of extrajudicial killings, survivors can now file class action lawsuits and can rest easy knowing that there is a government body ready to protect their rights. Reporting for KUTV, Mark Irongo Kagodha, Nairobi.
Now, the Deputy President today led the Kenya Kwanza campaigns in Nairobi, where he championed for the bottom-up economy. Ruto clarified the importance of protecting and investing in both small and medium enterprise in general to ensure that the business flourish. He also reiterated on lowering the cost of living.
Kenya Kwanza coalition led by the Deputy President today took their campaigns to Nairobi County in a vote hunting mission where they asked the resident to join hands and support them acquire victory in the coming elections. Ruto promised to change the economy through the bottom-up system in the event he clinches power after the elections. Among the many agendas he has for the country, he said reducing the cost of living will ensure that Kenyans are able to feed their families.
Ya kwamba, kama kuna mahali ambapo tunataka tubadilisha uchumi kwanza, ni hii Nairobi na Kenya mzima.
The Deputy President also clarified plans for youth employment highlighted in his manifesto, adding that the biggest challenge the youth face after graduating from school is lack of employment.
Wengi wanalala njaa. Bei ya unga imepanda, ya mafuta imepanda, ya mbolea imepanda. Na ndio tunasema agenda yetu ni kupunguza gharama ya maisha.
Fellow leaders from the coalition present asked residents to vote for William Ruto, a leader who will reduce the cost of living.
Sure of victory. What we want now is a decisive victory. Victory is there, but we want a decisive one.
Nyinyi ni watu wa kitenda wili ama nyinyi ni watu wa William Ruto? Wangapi watapigia William Ruto kura?
22 days are left to the face of the general elections as leaders from different parties are marshalling for votes in every part of the country to ensure victory come August 9th. Joy Pauline, KUTV.
And out of Motors Health, today 58 people have tested positive for COVID-19 from a sample size of 1,511 in the last 24 hours. The positivity rate is now at 3.8%. The total confirmed positive cases, therefore, are 336,798. 228 people have recovered from the virus, and the total number of recoveries is at 329,901. No patient has succumbed to the disease, therefore, the cumulative fatalities remains at 5,668. And on my chronometer, it's 19 minutes past the top of the hour. It's time we take our first break here on KUTV Primetime News. The moment we shall be coming back with the discussion of the night, the state of the race to the Agus post. The race, of course, to occupy the house on top of the hill. Don't want to miss this, so stay with us. See you on the other side.
Driving and riding without incidences on the road is such an amazing experience. But do you know while many road traffic crashes are avoidable, human behavior continues to be the leading cause? Speeding, lane indiscipline, drunk driving, distracted driving, failure to wear a helmet, and failure to use available pedestrian ways have been flagged by NTSA as the fatal six behaviors likely to lead to a fatal crash and serious injuries. As part of the Usalama Barabarani campaign, we request all road users to prevent these fatal six behaviors for their own safety and that of others. When driving, ensure your speed is within the stipulated limits. The road ahead is clear before overtaking. Stick to your lane. Keep left unless carefully overtaking. You're well rested if driving on long distances, and you never drink and drive. Usalama Barabarani starts with you. Fika Salama. This message is brought to you by the National Transport and Safety Authority and the European Union.
This is Mandela Gaya.
Ugonjwa ulipokuja ulichukua siku tatu ukaniweka in coma. 20 wamezikwa, wawili ndio wako hai.
I don't even know how it feels to see.
I feel like I cannot express myself well the way somebody who can walk can actually express themselves.
Ilichukua muda mwingi mrefu tena mpana.
I've come to actually accept myself.
Ukijaribu kumsimamisha mtu umwambie tafadhali nionyeshe njia.
They find it quite strange talking to you.
You should just make schools integrated.
Inclusive setups.
By providing the right facilities.
Bila shaka, mbiu ya mgambo ikilia, kuna jambo. Na sasa, katika KUTV Rise Today, makala ya TBT, tunaongeza kuni, tunawasha moto. Tunaingia barabarani kuangalia hali ilivyo, takwimu za corona na kupa. Habari zinazojiri na zinazokuhusu na kujuza na kukumbusha yaliyotendeka siku kama hii ndani ya historia. Kisha na kuletea wageni na wataalamu. Tudadavui, tufahamu na tuchukue nafasi yetu kama vijana katika uongozi, uchumi na masuala ya kisiasa nchini. Na joto likizidi, tunaingia uwanjani, tunachambua spoti ya Kenya. Ni kila Alhamisi, saa moja hadi saa nne asubuhi, nami Vincent Maina, almarufu Ojwang mtoto wa Mariam, ndani ya KUTV, a new experience.
I'm your host Esther Becky.
And my name is DJ Tero.
We start you off with a word of prayer and get you started with a live transformational worship experience. And have our minds renewed by the word of God on the word segment.
And not forgetting new music za hii wiki, yani ndakuwa bado na wapatia pale wasanii wamekuwa kiwakali. So make sure manzo ume tune in because takuwa zina flow pia pale mixes kwa wingi, yani takuwa zina come through, and pia performance yani from our gospel artist hapa on gospel art
from 7 to
10 a.m. only on KUTV.
Kwenye mitindo ya kipwani. Yani unavyoona basi niko kipwani pwani tu.
Unapopika inatakana uwe uko half cooked.
Tui ni nazi imekunwa, inawekwa kwa hii samaki juu. Wewe mwenyewe ukiangalia samaki mtazamaji, utaona vile inapendeza.
Niko Kilifi, niko katika kaunti ya Kilifi, Magavazi ya Gede.
Samaki mwenyewe ndio huyo. Huyo kidogo samaki kidogo iko na maajabu kwa sababu ni tumbo yake iko juu ya kichwa.
Karibu sana kwenye mitindo ya kipwani hapa KUTV, ukiwa nami nahodha mwendesha chombo si mwingine bali ni bibie huwa linalonukia na kuvutia Waridi Samu.
Stream live mitindo ya kipwani on our KUTV Facebook page every Saturday 4 p.m.
Possessing your property, intellectual or material.
This and more only on Law Matters.
shaka, mbiu ya mgambo ikilia, kuna jambo. Na sasa, katika KUTV Rise Today, makala ya TBT, tunaongeza kuni, tunawasha moto. Tunaingia barabarani kuangalia hali ilivyo. Takwimu za corona na kupa. Habari zinazojiri na zinazokuhusu na kujuza na kukumbusha yaliyotendeka siku kama hii ndani ya historia. Kisha na kuletea wageni na wataalamu. Tudadavui, tufahamu na tuchukue nafasi yetu kama vijana katika uongozi, uchumi na masuala ya kisiasa nchini. Na joto likizidi, tunaingia uwanjani, tunachambua spoti ya Kenya. Ni kila Alhamisi saa 1 hadi saa 4 asubuhi na mimi Vincent Maina almaarufu Ojwang mtoto wa Mariam ndani ya KUTV a new experience.
Welcome to Children's Corner. I am Welcome to
Children's Corner.
Children's Corner.
Kenyatta University will hold its 51st graduation ceremony on Friday, 22nd July 2022 at the main campus along the Thika Superhighway. KUTV will provide live coverage of the graduation ceremony from 8 a.m. The graduation ceremony will also be streamed live on KUTV and KU website, Lola app, and all KU social media platforms. For more information, please contact the Office of the Registrar Academic on 020-870-3092 or 07-86-33-5111 or visit the KU website at www.ku.ac.ke. Kenyatta University, transforming higher education, enhancing lives.
You are watching KUTV Primetime News with Omondi Otieno.
Welcome back and thank you for staying with us on KUTV Primetime News. And if you're just joining us, you're streaming live this broadcast on our social media platforms on Facebook, KUTV Kenya, and Twitter, KUTV underscore Kenya. It's also live on YouTube at KUTV Kenya Live. In the comment section, you can tell me what you think about the bulletin and as well for this discussion. If you might be having questions for my guest, tell me in the comment section. We'll be able to read them out to them. Now, the half of a decade narrowed down to years, months, weeks, and now just 21 days for the Kenyans to make a decision of their representatives for the next 5 years. It has been a tough race to convince the electorates to rally behind respective camps, and if the perception created by the polls are anything to go by, who will clinch the top seat come August 9th? It is the discussion of the night, and joining me is Calvin Keter, a youth leader in Kenya Kwanza, and Kotonde Kotonde, who is a political analyst. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining us for this discussion.
Thank you.
All right. Now, the state of the race, that is the discussion of the night. And, of course, we're talking about the race to occupy the house on top of the hill, that is the state house. So based on your analysis of how the political arena is, how things have been playing in the Kenyan political scene, how would you describe the state of this race? We'll start with you, probably Kotonde or Keter. Kotonde.
First of all, thank you very much for the invitation. I want to say clearly that the journey which started way back is probably being narrowed down because we have exactly 21 days to go. And based on the same, we as the Azimio Coalition, we are much focused on the same because we'll automatically give the best to this country.
Right. And now, Ketera, I don't know, what are you feeling about this race? Because we understand you're a lead, of course, in the Kenya Kwanza team. And if, you know, the perception that has been created by the different bodies that does the polls on this race, you know, they've stated clearly that the Azimio is ahead, of course, popular in some of the counties on something. What do you foresee of Kenya Kwanza in this state house race?
Thank you so much for giving us the chance to be here today. It's actually, the race is now getting clearer. The time frame, we have about 21 days to go before we have our fifth president. We've seen the latest polls being coming up. And the team of Kenya Kwanza, we are very confident with the numbers, as we've seen the mass population of Kenyans joining the bandwagon of the Aslan Nation. So if actually to go by the current perception of the talks we hear around, we are ultimately going to have William Ruto being the fifth president within the next 21 days.
All right, and it's actually interesting that you've told us of, you know, Kenyans rallying behind the bandwagon of the hustler narrative. And today, I think it was a reprieve, of course, for Kenyans, of which most of them are hustlers, with the price of unga being the government, of course, announcing a subsidy on maize flour from 230 shillings, so it shall be retailing at 100 shillings. Now, a lot of politics was dragged into this. Of course, we saw the Kenya Kwanza team led by the deputy president, of course, with the brigade that goes with him on these campaign trails in Nairobi. We saw even Musalia Mudavadi, the ANC party leader, and the Ford Kenya party leader, of course, Moses Wetangula. They're bringing in politics into this. They're saying, they're criticizing President Uhuru Kenyatta, saying that he's now, it is all politics. Do you think he was being sincere? The deputy president is being sincere with the sentiments, of course, he made about President Uhuru Kenyatta lowering the price of ugali?
Well, in reality, the price of ugali has not been actually lowered. The subsidy from currently 230 shillings per 2 kg mm-hmm. 200 is only a 4-week subsidy program. Mm-hmm. What our president-elect to be expected is the government should have made this long time ago, mm-hmm. whereby we would have seen the government investing more on farmers, increasing the rate of food production mm-hmm. long before we had this crisis. In a country at the equator, to suffer from effects of food insecurity mm-hmm. is not fair. So what we actually want to see the next government investing more mm-hmm. is increasing food production and ensuring that we have long-term solution to food crisis. Mm-hmm. We don't need the government to subsidize the cost of food.
All right.
Well, we could produce that.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, Kotonde, now, because you know, the directive that was given by the president, of course, which saw the price of maize now shall be retailing at 100 shillings. Do you think it was something motivated by politics? And as Keterov, of course, has outlined it, that the workers, the farmers need to be empowered so that we have enough and sufficient production locally. So do you think it was politics? Because we have seen the Kenya Kwanza team, of course, coming in, of course, blaming President Uhuru Kenyatta, saying that where was he when things were rising? What do you make of these sentiments by Kenya Kwanza?
Okay, first of all, I want to say categorically that the Kenya Kwanza are not sincere. Mm-hmm. The gentleman by the name of deputy president mm-hmm. was and has been in this very, very government. If he was in a position to at least come up with good strategies such that mm-hmm. he could change this narrative way back, it could have been much better now. Mm-hmm. But by virtue of now bringing issues to do with politics, I don't think it adds up. But looking at it going forward, it might not really help because it is just for a very short time. Mm-hmm. But I'd just advise the Kenya Kwanza team to stop politicizing almost everything. Yet they were in the same government. He has been enjoying all the coffers, plus what it takes within the office of the deputy president. Yes, so I will automatically prefer that he stop lying to Kenyans, but assist the government in at least achieving or even lowering other key commodities like oil, I mean paraffin, you know, those stuffs. Thank you.
All right. Maybe, Keter, I don't know, you have something burning, of course, to respond to that, because, you know, the deputy president has held office. There were, of course, calls for him to vacate the office, but he held tightly on his position. And now that you're optimistic, of course, that the Kenya Kwanza team is going to clinch the top seat, what do you foresee of the government with the deputy president, who has been blaming the government that he's under? What government, or rather leadership, do we foresee in the leadership optimistically if the deputy president clinches the top seat?
Well, first, I think we need to clearly understand the role of the deputy president in any government. And it is always that the deputy president is a principal assistant to the president. So at any time, all the direction that the country takes lies at the presidency. The only challenge which has been, well, that has been the case, that the deputy president has not been performing for the most part of the second term in office, basically because of being sidelined by the president. Mm-hmm. You've seen cases where, when even the president himself wanted to go back to his rural home, the person who stood with him to retain him in office was the deputy president. So actually, if it were not the case for the deputy president to ask the president to be firm on his role, maybe he would have sought to retire early. So we are actually going forward optimistically, considering that the deputy president is now the one at the helm. We expect that the next kind of leadership the country will have would be a dedicated leadership, the role of the president. On the issue of performance, of course, all the objects that the government has rolled out and the projects were from the president himself. So if the deputy president could not be able to take the lead on those, then that's why we didn't see him do well. Mm-hmm. Again, the cabinet has been run by the president and his team. Mm-hmm. Well, the deputy president we've seen that he was not even invited to some of the cabinet meetings. So he couldn't have any say or any role to play at that point.
Maybe, he is a leader, because actually we have seen on the campaign trails of Kenya Kwanza, we had what Kimani Ichung'wah was saying, the MP for Kikuyu was saying, that, you know, he was bringing to light things that are not known to Kenyans. There was the issue of a lot of construction, of course, going on, the road construction on the bypass that is connecting the Northland City, saying that some parts of the roads that were supposed to be constructed, I don't know where, funds were diverted, of course, to benefit President Uhuru Kenyatta as he's retiring. So, meaning these are things that were happening in their watch. They are things that were happening and they knew them. But now, because of politics of convenience, probably, that's why they are saying them right now. What do you make of such sentiments still, Keter?
To see that happening, in fact, it's interesting that we are at the Kenyatta University, where we've seen conflicts of interest in some of the government projects. When the president takes a firm decision to mismanage the economy, or to show an iron fist, you can barely do nothing. Mm-hmm. In fact, the Kenyatta University fraternity is a victim of what we've seen over, it's called state capture. Mm-hmm. And it's not only on allocation of government projects. Mm-hmm. Some of projects that were intended to benefit the mass population were not done adequately. And to this, I think the president had the sole firmness to deliberately take some actions which were not going to serve the majority of the Kenyans. Mm-hmm.
Right. Anyway, these things are coming out at a time when, of course, we are expecting new government to come into play. They are happening in the watch of leaders who did not, raise voices. They did not question this. They're only saying it to Kenyans at a time when Kenyans have barely, no voice or other action to take against this. Probably the action might be seen on the voting day, of course, on the 9th of August. So away from that, Kotonde, maybe to get back to you, we are seeing the race, of course, the strategies that these presidential candidates have been having, because, the presidential candidates, of course, they want to have a house where they have numbers, so that the decisions they want to have, some of the initiative probably they might be wanting to have in their government, of course, is supported by the members in the houses. And of course, we saw Raila Odinga, the ODM chief and the Azimio presidential candidate, asking Imran Okoth to step down to support, of course, the candidate that is the party's candidate, Peter Ocheng Orero. And we've seen the same sort of quote. It pierced through Mathare, and we saw how it pricked Bahati, who was asked to step down to support Anthony Oloy. So do you think, such actions, because we understand that these people who are being asked to step down, they have supporters, of course, because they have confidence that they are going to clinch this post. Don't you think this would probably hunt the Azimio side, the strategies that they are taking will hunt them, will haunt them, rather, on the polls day?
Thank you very much. Based on what is happening now, for me and many Kenyans, I don't think it is the right time to make such a decision. Mm-hmm. Why? Because maybe I can take you back. When we were having the primaries, the primaries were there so that you can get the best. But the primaries in this country, majorly for political primaries, are always full of malpractices. And the moment you do it in a shoddy way, you must expect some people who will automatically come up with different political parties, will automatically come with the independent parties. And as per the state of events, these people who are being told to step down for an individual, how sure are we as citizens of the country that given an opportunity, after being cowed to that level, they will clinch this position? Two, if they knew that the said person was the best, I think the best could have been, there could have been no primaries. Three, how will you go and convince my supporters? For example, if in case, how will I go and convince my supporters that I have been told otherwise by, we can call them our lords, that this person will be giving the best? And for me, I don't think that will be right, because we've seen that those who are so much into and being supported by a bigger party, they don't automatically give the best to the community. And therefore, we as Kenyans, we need to be given that opportunity. Like if you take the case of Homa Bay, the primaries were marred by a lot of study. Therefore, when the party decided to give out the ticket to one, Gladys Wanga, the other members who are cowed are now finding it difficult to even sell the very, very ticket. And the man who went with the independent candidate is now the talk of the day.
Right.
Meaning people are tired of this, we call it being cowed to the level that it must just be a party, but people are going towards electing an individual who is well to do with what the society needs.
All right.
Thank you.
Now, Keter, probably still on the same note, we've seen the issue of zoning eliciting mixed reactions, not in the Azimio side alone. It cuts across all the parties. Of course, it's also in the Kenya Kwanza. And Kotonde has put it right that, the party is favoring someone, we need this person, but it might be a different decision, it might be a different thought, of course, with the electorates, who are most importantly the people who make the decision of who should represent them in the houses. What do you make of this issue of zoning? Do you think probably on this time we might be having a situation where Kenyans are voting more independent candidates than the party candidates, as has been put by Kotonde here?
Well, I actually think elections should give everybody a fair play to participate. As a citizen of a country, you have a role to take part in nation building, and nobody should actually dictate to what extent you have to play or to what extent somebody has to step on you. You can look at this, in, for example, in a football play, where while everybody's playing in the field, and then suddenly when somebody has the ball, he's being asked to leave it so that somebody else have to kick it. Mm-hmm. Well, it is not democratic, and actually it undermines the principles to which we hold our democracy. Mm-hmm. So for the coalitions, our parties, we expect them to take the lead, mm-hmm. and to actually be democratic and give everybody a chance to take part in the elections. The case of zoning actually is of interest to a few who are at the top. Mm-hmm. When they look at the numbers they expect to have in the parliament or the senate, and then they have to ask some candidates to step in favor of the others, mm-hmm. which we actually want to condemn as young leaders. And going forward, we want to see more level playground being given to all candidates. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If you may just add. Okay, when it comes to issues to do with zoning, mm-hmm. I totally disagree with it. Why do I disagree with it? Mm-hmm. I do disagree with it because, one, it robbed the citizens of that very region the right to give their best to one of their own. Mm-hmm. Two, zoning gives room for those who are deep-pocketed. We as the youth of this country, when will we have the millions to at least convince the electorate that it is our time to give the youthful leadership? And therefore, when it comes to zoning, mm-hmm. you will automatically know that the party owners will automatically carry the day. Mm-hmm. Yeah, if you are deep pocket, you will automatically carry the day.
All right.
Thank you.
All right, away from that, probably because for the interest of time, we should be doing probably just a precursor of the presidential debate, of course, that tomorrow shall be featuring the running mates of the top seats. And maybe borrowing from what we saw in the gubernatorial debate and other debates that have been conducted by different media houses, what do you foresee in this debate? Because we saw, of course, in the gubernatorial race, from the insights, of course, Kenyans had probably maybe people, electorates in the city saying that we shall be voting on this side based on what our candidate was saying, we shall be voting on this side. Now, it was giving the electorates a chance to make a firm decision on who to support. And so tomorrow we shall be having, of course, Rigathi Gachagua of the Kenya Kwanza and Martha Karua, of course, of the Azimio side, and other, of course, running mates of the other presidential candidates. Keteru, we'll start with you. Where do you see the weight tilting from the debate of tomorrow?
Well, tomorrow is a great day to have our deputy presidents being having a chance to express themselves. For a better part of the year, now that since the selection of deputy presidents by the presidential candidates, mm-hmm. we expect to see Rigathi Gachagua now come out clearly and express himself clearly to the people, mm-hmm. because as we've seen, many people may not understand his will for the country. Mm-hmm. So tomorrow we expect him to come out vibrantly, mm-hmm. to share his vision for the country, mm-hmm. and to defend the manifesto that has come out. Mm-hmm. And I am very optimistic that he is well prepared for the day, mm-hmm. and it will come out clearly that the Kenya Kwanza is actually prepared to take the nation forward. Mm-hmm.
And of course, probably just on a light note, we expect the question of gender, which has always, the gender card, of course, has always been a point of criticism for the Kenya Kwanza team. And of course, there's Kenyans have already started talking about, you know, the funny thing, of course, they talk about whenever the deputy, or rather the running mate of the Azimio, or not Azimio rather, but the Kenya Kwanza side, should always be given the microphone to talk. Don't you think we shall be having, of course, maybe such talks tomorrow from the Kenyans, kwamba, you know, Gachagua pewe mic, something of that sort. You know, of course, what I mean when I say that.
Yeah, I think Gachagua is actually a great leader. Mm-hmm. From his track of performance we've seen. It's not the first time he's taking a role in leadership. So he's been serving the community through different ranks. He has been serving children, he's been serving youth, women, and all the people in the society. Mm-hmm. So it is not the first time that he's being in charge of a community.
All right.
Again, to add on it, is actually to say that Kenya Kwanza has had, recently launched the Women Charter, where it's proposed a wonderful manifesto to favor the women and the girl childs in the population. So we have incorporated the women in our manifestos, and we actually have an agenda to improve their lives as well.
All right. Yeah. As we wind up this discussion, Kotonde, what do you feel of the tomorrow's debate? Do you think, you know, the presidential, the running mate, of course, in the Kenya Kwanza, in the Azimio side, will tilt the votes, the numbers for the Azimio?
First of all, I want you to know very well, and the Kenyans at large, that Azimio has what it takes for the women of this country. We are going to make a history by electing Martha Karua as the very first woman in the Kenyan politics, as the most expensive and serious office in this land. Two, tomorrow I expect this staff to be addressed by my deputy president, that is economic recovery, issues to do with corruption, I know will automatically crop in, and even the integrity of our members of the other side, that is the Kenya Kwisha. Other issues will be the youths. In the Azimio team, this is what I want you to know, Bwana Keter, we have different leagues running this stuff. We have the Women League, which is properly structured. We have the Youth League, which is properly structured. We also have the Wababa team, which is equally super.
Right.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And I request you, while you will be having, in case you'll be having an opportunity to be there, the Kenya Kwisha, mm-hmm. kindly don't make it to be so hyped to the level that you make a lot of noise, because we expect this to be the most decent, the most smart in all the races we've been having, sir.
All right.
Thank you.
All right, that's it, gentlemen. Because of the interest of time, of course, we just maybe pause it at that point. We shall carry it on, of course, a later day, of course, maybe in the course of next week, and the presidential, the deputy president's running mate, the deputy president's debate shall be airing tomorrow on KUTV as well. You shall be tuning in to get the insights of everything happening. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for coming. We appreciate your input on this discussion. Taking a short break, shall we come back in a moment?
KUTV, in conjunction with Kenyatta University Funeral Home, is now offering death announcements immediately following our news bulletins at 7 p.m. At this sorrowful time, as we share in your grief, allow us to communicate your announcement of your loved one on KUTV in both Kiswahili and English. For more details, kindly inquire at the KU Funeral Home Service Desk or call 0736-928-380 or dial 020-359-9054.
Sasa ni bora zaidi, mwanzo mpya, mambo mapya. Msimu mwingine wa boresha kilimo unakuletea teknolojia ibuka, kilimo mseto, uongezaji thamani. Teknolojia digitali ya mauzo, inawezesha ufikiaji wa masoko. Sokomoko yako, mahangaiko yako ya kufikia masoko yamefika kikomo, manake tunao Mkulima Young.
What Mkulima Young does is it connects farmers with the market.
Hii ni Boresha Kilimo kwa ushirikiano na Mkulima Young. Atafutaye hachoki na kichoka kesha pata. Kwa makala maalum ya kilimo, ungana nasi kila Jumamosi saa 6:30 kwenye kipindi ukipendacho Boresha Kilimo.
This is KUTV Primetime News with Omondi Otieno.
Welcome back. Thank you for staying with us. Let's carry on with the bulletin. Now, former Nyali Member of Parliament, Aaron Awiti, fears his life is in danger after he was allegedly attacked by goons in Likoni on Wednesday last week. Awiti has asked the relevant officers to apprehend the leaders allegedly behind the planning of the said attack. Similarly, in Kisii, peace ambassadors have warned the youth to shun being misused by politicians to cause violence during the ongoing campaigns.
After he was allegedly attacked by armed thugs in Likoni, Mombasa on Wednesday last week, former Nyali Member of Parliament Aaron Awiti has expressed fears for his life. Awiti has claimed that the attack occurred during a rally attended by the Azimio la Umoja One Kenya presidential candidate Raila Odinga during his four-day tour of the coast region that ended on Friday.
Si mara ya kwanza ilikuwa kwa convoys of Right Honorable Prime Minister Nyali Bridge, nilipigwa kama mbwa. Jana pia nilipigwa kama pigwa hapa na pilipili ikaingia kwa macho, ikaingia kwa swimming pool.
The former legislator, who is also vying for the Mombasa gubernatorial seat, said his campaign team in Jomvu was also attacked and beaten up on their way to Bangladesh village, leaving a number of them nursing serious injuries.
Kila mtu akona haki ya kulindwa. Yoyote yule anagombea kiti, alindwe na apewe uhuru wa kuingia popote pale, kuongelesha wananchi, ndio aweze kuuza sera zake.
Kwa authority, sisi hatuna silaha. Sisi hatuko kwa vita. Sisi tunataka kuexercise our democratic rights. Kwa hivyo sisi hatutaki mtu ambaye atatuingilia kivyo vyote.
At the same time, human rights activists and survivors of gender-based violence in Kisii County have challenged the youth to shun from being misused by politicians to cause violence during the ongoing elections campaigns.
Serikali yetu isimame na sisi aswa kina mama. Watupatie msaada kwa vijana wetu, maana vijana wetu ndio wanatumiwa na wa politicians kwenda kuleta vurugu.
Most of the counties in Nyanza and the lower South Rift region are on the lead because of the several past ethnic skirmishes. Kwa upande wa Kisii tumekuwa na shida wakati wa 2013.
The youth were instead urged to focus on self-advancement for their future by conducting themselves responsibly.
We are calling upon the government to maintain peace now and during and even after the elections. And I'm pleading to you, my various youths out there, let us not be used as instruments of violence.
This comes a few days after religious leaders, organizations and movements such as Africans Rising Movement called for peaceful elections on August 9th. Caroline Kimwele for KUTV.
Casual workers at Konza Technopolis have cited frustrations, threats and attacks by foreign supervisors manning the construction of the Kenya Advanced Institute of Science and Technology University. Some of the casual workers are currently admitted at hospital in Machakos County after they were allegedly electrocuted by an administrator of Bomi Consortium, a company from Korea that oversees the construction. Higher Education PS Ambassador Simon Obukwesi, who visited the site, access to the situation, raised a doubt as whether the contractor has a work permit and if their company is fully registered with the construction organizations. Obukwesi visited the patients at the hospital and assured them of their safety and demanded that those whose jobs had been terminated to be compensated and immediately reinstated back to work. He said that the investigations continue. The company will have to provide details of their qualification, work permit, and warned that action will be taken against the perpetrators once investigations are concluded.
Waliojeruhiwa wakatibiwa wakaachiliwa, na kuna wale ambao wako bado kwa hospitali naenda kuwaona hivi sasa. Kuna wawili wako kwa hospitali tangu siku ile kwa sababu walipelekwa kule kama wamepoteza fahamu.
Akashika ofaro na akanifalisha uso na kichwa, akanitega chini.
Huyo
eh, wakanitega chini wakaanza huyo Kim na huyo John site manager. Sasa wakaanza kunipiga hapo chini.
Naambiwa enda, kazi yako imeisha, jioni mtu mwingine analetwa. Hiyo ndio na feel, mbona niambiwa hakuna kazi, sijafanya makosa na kazi yenyewe naona iko.
Basi walitakana kuwa watu wa kuzungumza kizungu, lakini wote hawazungumzi kizungu, wanazungumza lugha yao. Ndio sababu mawasiliano yao na wafanyakazi sio yale ambayo yanawawezesha kuelewana.
Let's now take a look at what's happening in the world of sports. Now, Windsor's Kanana Mudomi and Kiambu's Peter Waiharu were named the overall winners of the 12th leg of the Safaricom Golf 2 Junior tournament held at the Kenya Air Force Golf Club. 12-year-old Mudomi carded 41 points to claim the best girl title for the second time after taking the top prize category during the fifth leg of the tour in Machakos. Peter Waihuria won the boys' title after falling short last weekend in Nakuru. Sunday's tournament witnessed 85 juniors participate in the event, with 60 juniors showing up for the golf clinic, which was part of the day's activities. With only two legs remaining before the grand finale on the 6th of August in Vipingo Ridge, the tour has so far attracted close to 6,000 golfers who have taken part in the various tournaments, junior clinics and outreach programs. The next leg of the tour is scheduled for the 23rd of July at Vetlab Golf Club.
It takes in a lot of effort since I don't only want to be number one in my category but also overall winner for girls. So I have to try and play as low as possible. Today I didn't really have a good day, but I tried.
Hii ndio mara yangu ya pili nimecheza Nakuru, and here I am a winner and I'm very grateful.
Right, and with that, we call it a wrap here on KUTV Primetime News. Many thanks indeed for your valued company throughout the bulletin. Our sign language interpreter tonight has been Moses Gitonga. My name is Omondi Otieno. It's also very interesting, of course, that the sports that we read today was about golf. Cameron Smith is the one who won the latest tournament. That is the 150th championship. That was at the oldest golf course in Scotland called St. Andrews. Have a great night. We shall be meeting next week.
KUTV, in conjunction with Kenyatta University Funeral Home, is now offering death announcements immediately following our news bulletins at 7 p.m. At this sorrowful time, as you share in your grief, allow us to communicate your announcement of your loved one on KUTV in both Kiswahili and English. For more details, kindly inquire at the KU Funeral Home Service Desk or call 0736-928-380 or dial 020-359-9054.
Driving and riding without incidences on the road is such an amazing experience. But do you know, while many road traffic crashes are avoidable, human behavior continues to be the leading cause. Speeding, lane indiscipline, drunk driving, distracted driving, failure to wear a helmet,